For this next section, we're going to talk about thinking about the images you're going to be using and kind of the some of the tools that we use to capture them and some best practices for capturing them, as well as thinking a little differently about the pictures you're taking, the videos that you're shooting. I'm sure many of you've heard the best camera is the one that's with you. And I fully appreciate that and agree with it, especially these days. Basically now, anyone that has one of these in their pocket, you've got your own little high-res camera, video editor, social media computer right in your pocket. I probably use this for about 80% of my work. Running around campus, taking pictures, sharing to social media, even doing some quick video editing. And it's great. Anymore, the definition that I get is it's perfect for web use. If I was making a grand, huge cinema movie on the big screen, it's totally different. But when you're doing anything for the web, most smartphones can capture everything that you need. And the convenience can't be beat. If you told me 10 years ago I would have everything that I can do in this right in my pocket, I would think you're absolutely crazy. But just the computing power on these are incredible. So if you've got a smartphone, you're basically good to go anymore. The point and shoots that are out are great too. I use all Nikon equipment when it comes to camera equipment, but all the brands are very comparable. Many of you know the whole Mac versus PC argument. Some people are very steadfastly one way or another. The Canon and Nikon people tend to be the same way. Canon's better, Nikon's better. They all. They all capture everything that you could ever need for what you're doing in science communication. Olympus is great. They're all wonderful. And like I was saying, even the point and shoots, the Nikon Coolpix are just a little bit bigger than this and can do really nice video and pictures. And they've even been used, as well as iPhone now, I have to say, have been used to, there we go, there's one right there. Cover photos for National Geographic have been taken by these now, officially. So if it's good enough for National Geographic, then I feel that I'm in good company. And some of the iPhone 6 billboards you see now, these huge, beautiful images, billboard size, were taken with a phone. So you really can't beat this for convenience and always being connected and sharing on the go, which is a lot of fun to do in science, especially when something is exciting in the field. That being said, there are plenty of other tools that you can carry with you and use for more specific reasons, and I've got a lot of them here today. Basically, my other go-to camera anymore is the simple little GoPro. It's one of several action cams that are out there now. GoPro's been around, one of the first and longest lasting, so they're pretty well proven in the field and can do most anything, really high definition video. And the great thing about these is you can kind of stick them anywhere. They're also water resistant and very easily waterproofed with the little cases that they come with, like right here. So when you're around water and doing a lot in the marine science, I have officially, much to my husband's disappointment, drowned three of these. So I can tell you about the best cases if anyone's looking for a really good phone case. He keeps upgrading my case, and some of them just kind of, you know, sank. But if you're doing a lot around water, the GoPros are wonderful because you can get the waterproof case. The cases you can switch out in the back, and they even have a nice little floaty case that I use a lot. So if it does tumble into the water, you'll see it bobbing and you can fish it out. And it also has a lot of different attachments that make it really useful for getting different angles. This is a really simple, basically an extension stick, and I use this a lot. This was $20 on Amazon. Very inexpensive, but very, very useful. I can telescope it out and use it in a lot of different ways. If I'm on the boat, I can put the waterproof case on and I can put it over the side of the boat and get it into the water. If I'm in a crowded situation, I can get a really high view overhead. If there's some action, a lot of people like going by, or someone going by in scuba flippers, I can kind of get it on the ground and get that footage, just standing still and just rotating the stick. So this is just one of many different accessories you can get. I find this kind of extension stick is one of the most useful. The cases are made, they're pretty ingenious. They all loosen up with a screw at the bottom, so you can switch them out really easily between different mounts. So this pulls right off and can go on different mounts. You can get a really simple one to use on the tripod. If you're using your smartphone for everything and you only buy one other piece of equipment, I would definitely recommend getting a decent tripod. For stabilization, especially for shooting video. You can actually use a GoPro on the tripod too. They make a really simple little tripod stand that you can screw right into the top of a tripod as well. And then if you're on the go, they have several more action type attachments. They've got ones that you can put on helmets, elastic that you can put right over a hard hat if you're on a research vessel or if you're on a moving vehicle. This is one of my favorite. It's called the Chesty. It can actually put it on, and I've got it right here. If you're doing some cool if you're doing trawling and bringing fish on board and you're pulling the fish out of the net, this gives you a really cool kind of first person hands-on view. Because you've got the camera right there and you can see everything that your hands are doing without having to worry about the camera. So you can kind of set it and forget it. And this little Chesty thing, the hat view is kind of cool too, but this kind of gives you exactly what your hands are doing. And they even have a dog mount too. If anyone else is a dog person, you can actually mount your GoPro on your dog and get a dog's eye view. But we've actually used that mount on some different things, like little robots and AUVs. If you've got a robot that's doing something interesting, you want to give that view, you can get creative with some of the mounts as well. The other thing that I should mention about these GoPros is that they've got a fisheye lens, a really wide angle lens on it. So you get a really wide view of everything that's going on. So basically, almost from edge to edge, you get a nice view of the landscape, of the action that's happening. So the GoPro is kind of my backup, weatherproof, drop-proof, klutz-proof camera. And the other one that I keep kind of in my pocket anymore is a little more advanced. This is a VR camera. I'll show you. This gives you a full immersive 360 view. It's very tiny, but it's got two lenses on each side, and each one is a 180 degree lens. And the camera automatically stitches the two images together into a full 360 immersive view. They're relatively inexpensive. We bought this one off of a grant for some of the work we're doing. It was just over $300, I think. But it takes stills, it takes video, and it will also do a live feed via Wi-Fi. So if you're doing something in a very interesting place where you want to give that immersive feel, to give you an idea of some of the footage, this is our wind turbine. So you can go online and you can kind of zoom around and explore what it's like on the ground there. And it can be used in many different ways. You can also use it, you can bring it up on smartphones for anyone using a VR viewer like Google Cardboard. And you can have it in that immersive way. They bring it up on their phone, put it right in here. This kind of Velcros out. Stick the phone in, and if you look through, it gives you that full 3D view. So you can kind of spin around, look up, look down, just like you're right there on site. The example I showed yesterday was on the Droides Resolution, which is a drilling ship. I'm doing a full tour on this that folks can access. But you can look down. You see that little red dot right there? That's basically the base of this stick. So it really captures that full 360. So online, people can scan through, look all the way up into the derrick, look around. Or in the viewer, it would be like you're standing right underneath of it. I do have viewers for everybody today. I had to put them in a suitcase like this. So the only bad part is that we're all going to have to put these together. So that'll be our arts and crafts time today, where if you have a smartphone, you can, when we put it together, it will look just like this. And you can actually experiment some in Google Cardboard and this Round Me app, which I'll talk about a little bit later, is the one that we're using right now for the VR. The cool thing about like this Round Me app is that you can actually add in additional information. So I showed a quick screen capture yesterday, but as you look around, let me reload this. Like when you look up, you see the little information. You can actually embed like photographs, links, and other information. In this case, we've put one of our 15-second science in talking about how the drilling surface works.
Did you know that scientists drill deep beneath the seabed to learn more about the microbial life that resides there? Specialized ships enable researchers to drill into the ocean floor and extract sediment core samples, allowing them to study the microbial communities and geologic history of different regions.
So in this platform, I took a simple picture underneath, and I was able to just upload it to the site. The site's free to use, very easy to use. It's drag and drop. I was able to put that little information bubble in, put in my YouTube link, and then I've got that little information portal in there. So it's really great for building kind of virtual field trips, taking people places where they might not be allowed to go or might not be able to see in real life. And then you can link them together pretty easily using some of their portals, which you can actually, when you're in here, you can move from place to place when you put the portals in by just staring at it for 3 seconds. Technology of that amazes me. I don't know how it does it, but if you just stare at a point on your screen, it will take you into the next virtual space, which is really cool. So I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But this is the camera. Again, very simple to use, very easy to carry with you, and not very expensive. Last year, just about 12 months ago, you used to have 6 GoPros, like all connected in an array. You had to time them all together to get this kind of footage. And then you had to take all that footage and stitch it together. And it's a much more complicated process than something like this.
Yeah, that was kind of my question. Because can you use this kind of programs with maybe panoramic views or other stuff that you don't need this camera?
You can upload a panorama view, but you're not going to get the full 360. You can kind of spin around, but you're not going to get the down and the up that you can with that. Mm-hmm. And there's several different platforms, and they all have some different features. We just really like the Round Me because it works really well in web browsers as well as their app. And on the app, you can use the app like this, where you can kind of look around and explore the image. But then you can also split the screen to use in the Google Cardboard for the full immersive experience.
Okay. Another question. Do you know whether there's any waterproof casing for the VR camera?
There is. We haven't gotten it yet. We're waiting for a slightly better one because we've read that it overheats pretty quickly in there. There are some waterproof other brands. There's one called the Fly 360 or 360 Fly. We use that on one cruise. One of our researchers had it. It works good as well. The clarity is not as good on the imagery, and it has a really a wide footprint. So when you look down, there's a much bigger space where it's just kind of all pixelated. But it kind of looks like a large golf ball, and it's you can actually immerse that one very easily. And then a couple other ones have come out. One is Nikon Key Mission 360, and I've got links to these in that resource document that is going to be on there. It links to all these 360 cameras. And that one is supposedly waterproof, but it came out last month, and I've heard they've been having a lot of technical issues. So we've used this in a lot of different situations, and so far it's worked great for us. This was one of the test situations. I was in Cape Town with the Geordie's Resolution, and I kind of set it up to get the Boulders Beach to get the geology of the area, because we're talking a lot about rocks, and I walked away, I'm standing right there. And in this case, a very curious penguin started coming down the stairs right at the camera. I actually use this when people get in the VR to kind of get situated. I bring this up first and have them find the penguin to get used to looking around. But on a beautiful day, like the clarity and resolution on this for being instant, is it just can't be beat. And it connects wirelessly to my phone. So I can take a picture with this, transfer it right to my phone, and then post it from the app. So I can go from this to having it live on the web and sharing it on social media in 2 minutes tops. So it all works really well together. Is there another question?
Is it possible
to,
am I speaking loud?
You can do it in the round me, you can do it with the little information spots. I've tried putting into Photoshop a couple different ways, and I've been able to do some slight image tweaking, but if I do too much, somehow it loses the metadata that reads it as a 360. And I'm not sure that technical glitch, and I haven't had time to look into that yet. But I know, with the video, you can actually do some more editing in the video with some of the different video programs and add some of the subtitles and more active stuff. But this is all really kind of in the beginning, so there's still a lot of hiccups, so they're kind of working out. But it's an exciting time because it's finally getting down to the consumer side, and it's so easy to use. So I'll take those couple hiccups to kind of give that fuller experience, and as more and more people use it, that should be ironed out pretty quickly. And also, when I take this and I transfer it right to my phone, I can also upload it very easily to Facebook page, and Facebook supports the 360. So when we've done some of our teacher workshops, we did a bay to bay where we went from one bay to the ocean. We stopped at some really cool places and went kayaking. I took images throughout the day and then shared kind of a virtual experience so teachers that couldn't come on the workshop could see exactly what we were doing, and then linked it to some of the resources that we were talking about too. So that's the type of thing right now, since it's new, that really kind of pops off of a Facebook page compared to some other posts. Get back to this one.
Just a question. Mm-hmm. Is it a problem to the solution, but to mix all those platforms, because you can use a Vimeo and its presentation, and then your own account and everything then mixed together on different tools. Is there some
pieces of advice to organize all that?
Yeah, we'll talk a little bit more about the platforms in the next section. But a lot of them are now working well together. So once you kind of figure out how you can partner up and kind of multitask on the different platforms, they're all playing together well, pretty well now. And now you're getting options with like the story maps, which I can bring up the one I talked about yesterday a little bit later, where the story maps are kind of integrating all these things so you can pull them all into one kind of beautiful story where you've got the pictures and you've got your links and you've got the maps with the data and then you've got these YouTube clips that play automatically and it's all packaged together. So it used to be much more complex where you had to go into the website and you had to figure out how to embed all these different things, but the technology is getting there where they work pretty seamlessly together. One more thing on the mobile side before I get to the more complex. In using the smartphone, a couple other things that are really useful to have, if you know you're going to be outside and kind of in the field or away for the day, they make little microphones for smartphones that are actually quite great. I use this little one that's called Smart Mic. You can also find it under iMic. It's very little. It plugs right in and you can bend it in whichever direction the sound is. I use this in the field if I'm getting a little video clip of someone speaking. It just, especially with my heavy duty case, it picks up the sound a little better and it comes with a little windscreen if you're outside in nature. I also use this now on Facebook Live. You can live stream events very, very easily off your Facebook page with basically two clicks. You can go live. I do that right off of the smartphone. Again, I always have my trusty tripod. And you can get a really easy attachment for the tripod. Just screws right on here. And it just holds, it grabs your cell phone and holds it in place. So if I'm doing a Facebook Live event, I just screw this on. Basically, plug the mic in. Whoops. I'm all upside down. Clip it in, and I've got my Facebook Live camera ready to go right in front. For the NMEA conference this year, we didn't have a huge communications crew doing any live streaming or anything. It was me sitting in the front row, putting my smartphone on with this little microphone and hitting live before every keynote, and it went automatically live to our page. And the sound was good enough for anyone to hear from far away. And the nice thing about the Facebook Live events is as soon as you're done, you just hit stop, and it automatically archives it on your page. So for us, with the National Marine Educators Association, we don't have a huge staff. I'm it. I'm the only paid staff, and I'm part-time. So when we do some of these things, we don't have a budget to do any of this. But we figure out ways where we can make do. And this worked well for the conference. Because Facebook automatically archived it, I then had the link that I could share on our website and on social media. And the views for those little recordings of our keynotes and our panels are some of our highest viewed materials, because not everyone was able to make it to the conference down to Orlando, and they were able to listen to these panel discussions and talks and can embed that right into a shareable blog. So you can also go live on YouTube, you can go live on Twitter, you can go live on Periscope. There are several different ways to do it. We've primarily used Facebook just because they've made it so easy with their app, and then we've got that capability to share it so easily afterwards. Then the only other thing on going mobile is I can't stress having one of these enough. This is just an extra battery charger to take with you. This can charge my cell phone up to 4 times. Just plug it into a wall to charge up before I go. Having, if you get one of these and you know you're carrying a GoPro or one of these as well, having one with 2 USB ports is a good idea because I can plug in both my phone and my GoPro right into my backpack and I don't have to worry about the battery dying or running around to find a place to plug in. So this easily lasts me a full day with a couple of these little cameras. So between this, the phone, GoPro, and this, I can fit it all into a very small backpack and be quite mobile and get a lot of different interesting footage.
Mm-hmm. One comment on the tripod and the little adapter for smartphones. You can't go live landscape-wise on Facebook if you have an Android.
So ah.
That's one thing that I found out in the hard way. and had to stand for 2 hours, my Android phone. So I think they're working on the capability, but just one.
That's good to know. Was everyone able to hear that? If you have an Android, you can't go live in this view. You have to have it up. Before I purchase any of this, I always kind of look into reviews and what other people say. So if you've got a phone that's a little bit different, it's always good to check that out because it's nice to know beforehand. Otherwise, you get pretty shaky pretty quick. One other word on the tripod. When you this is one of the best investments you can make. Make sure it's lightweight. Spending extra $20 to have something a little lighter, your back will really appreciate that. And have something that has a movable head. So if you're doing video, you can see how that slides around nice and easily. So it holds your phone or whatever camera you're using nice and still for doing video shots. But then you can also do something like a little pan around the room where it's nice and smooth and you're not just focused on one area. And if you want to upgrade a little bit more, you can get a ball head, which again, you can come up and look at this. You can change your angle somewhat here. And in this case, I can go always sideways. So if I had that Android, I could clip it sideways and still be able to. The ball heads are a little bit more expensive, but it's worth that little extra to have that capability in moving around your shots and your angles. And I don't always use the tripod, like just standing there. I use it as an extension. I'll do this, just like the GoPro, if I've got the larger camera, to get the more interesting angle. Or I've actually stuck it in the backpack when I've got the bigger camera on, walking to get kind of that moving shot. So you can think creatively with your tripod as well. I've also kind of used it on my shoulder to keep it stable if I'm doing something like that. So you don't just have to use it with the legs on the ground. They also make monopods, which are a little simpler. I ran out of room to bring one of those. But a monopod is mono one, just a straight stick down. That's great if you're moving around or really kind of hiking. Because you can hold something still, but then you can also use it as a walking stick, especially if you have a pack full of gear on. I use a monopod a lot when I know I'm moving around. It's basically has all the functionalities of this, but it's a little more streamlined. I'm getting a little more complex. If I know I'm going to be doing kind of a video that's going to be shared more widely or might get some use in presentations or in university stories, I upgrade to the DSLR. I use one of these rather than a pure video camera just because it has the flexibility to take still images and video images. I rather just carry one. Then carry two, and the imagery I can get on this again is as good as I need, even for using on like a television presentation. This is again Nikon. I use I'm up on the D70 or D750, but anything from some of their lower. We also use a D40 which is great. And we do have a Coolpix in our fleet that does photo and video that does quite well as well. With the DSLR, that stands for digital single lens reflex. It's just the type of camera and how it captures the image. But it's nice in that you can switch out lenses on these. I have kind of a portrait lens, which is nice for video on it now. But if I know there's going to be a lot of action far away, I can put a bigger zoom lens on here and use it. When you use those bigger lenses, again, the tripod's nice to have because those get heavy really quick. And then you can use different microphones just by clipping them right on top and plugging into the mic jack. This is like a little shotgun mic, which is good in really general situations. If I'm getting B-roll where I want some natural sound, if we're out on the ship and I want those seagull sounds calling overhead, this does a great job. If I'm doing interviews, it's good to have a more directed mic. You can either be connected. This is a really simple one. It's called a lavalier mic, real tiny, like I'm wearing for today. You can clip right on somebody. These are less expensive, that are actually hard corded right onto the phone, or sorry, onto the camera. So this can be a trip hazard and can be kind of cumbersome. If you're moving around a lot with people, having a system that's more mobile is helpful. So in this system, it's just wireless. One part attaches to the camera. The other part attaches to the person. I'm actually wearing one today. So you can see it's hooked right here, hooked here, but I'm free. I can move around anywhere I want without worrying about tripping over the cords. So the wireless are just a little more expensive, but if you know there's going to be a lot of movement or you're going to be changing locations several times, it's worth a little extra than to worry about winding up the cord, or if you're clumsy like me, I get tangled up in it. So there's a couple different mic options. Sound is something that's not easy to fix, so it's worth it to spend a little to have another microphone on the camera, because the internal microphones aren't the best on these. They take really good imagery, and Nikon is known for imagery, so that's where their brand reputation lies. So the built-in microphone is going to be decent but not wonderful. Adding the little extra microphone to get the better quality audio makes a huge difference, especially when you have people speaking, because it's able to really kind of capture the voice that's right there and keep out some of the other sounds. If you have a lot of distracting background noises, it can really mess with your audio. One other thing when doing sound with these cameras is there's always a headphone jack right next to the microphone jack. And I always plug in earbuds or simple headphones. I usually use earbuds just because they're simpler to travel with. It just helps you hear exactly what the microphone is catching. Just in case you forgot to turn on the microphone or the plug's not in all the way, which happens, you're setting it up really quickly and you forget to hit the on switch. I use the headphones at least the first couple minutes to make sure the sound that I'm hearing through the phones is what I want, and that everything is working correctly. So it never hurts to have some headphones with you as well. I think that's it for all the equipment I have up here today. Oh, the one thing I did not mention, on the tripod side are these little gorilla pods. Anyone use these? These are awesome. They're small. They come in several sizes. I've got a bigger version that actually holds the bigger camera. But when you're out and about and you're wanting to secure your camera in kind of an unusual spot, they're flexible. You just screw it right into the top. You can grip it around a tree branch, a fence post, whatever you have around you to secure the camera for some different shots. I use this one a lot with the GoPro. I'm going to show a time lapse a little bit later, Sometimes I know I'm going to be too busy to take pictures or get footage, so I'll do a time lapse of a scene. And when you have something like this, I can attach the GoPro right to it, and I can hang it from something within the room and put it on a time lapse mode and get kind of action throughout the day, kind of set it and forget it type thing. So especially if there's an event and it's in a tent and there's like tent supports, those are really good to hang from. So it's useful for these little cameras as well. And again, the resource document that I'm sharing out has links to all these as well. This is another very inexpensive but very useful investment and fun to play with. Let me get this out of the way. So when we're actually, we've got all this equipment and we're going out there and we're trying to figure out what we're going to capture, you really need to, you've got your kind of kernel of the idea and you've got your storyboard. And when you're thinking about the imagery, it's really important to think through exactly what you want to show with the story. Imagery is key in stories. The pictures can really help illustrate a concept or a place. Animated GIFs are a lot of fun, especially in social media, where you show just like a little part of the video in a looping animation. If something really fun happens, like you're pulling a shark out of the water to tag it, having that on a loop can really grab people's attention on in a social media feed. Or having short, fun little clips from a longer piece, having a really good quote of somebody saying something that piques people's interest. Kind of keeping all these things in the back of your mind is important when you're doing the planning part. Anytime, particularly in science, showing that kind of first person or hands-on perspective, putting the viewer in the main character's shoes is interesting because it literally puts them in that place. That's why I love that chest mount, because I can clip that to anybody. That sometimes they give me funny looks, or I have to like figure out how to put it underneath a PDF, but I'm getting the imagery from that person's perspective, and that can be really unusual for folks to see. Again, going up high, going down low, going underwater, getting those views that aren't expected. If you have a really great budget and you can get a quadcopter that can hold one of those GoPros and you can get above and really get a bird's eye view. The first video we saw, you saw some of those views above the snowy trees and above the houses. Those kind of unexpected views, if you can get them, are just really fun. And sometimes you just have to, again, kind of stand where you are, look around and figure out how you might be able to get that without the big budget. I go on a lot of roofs of buildings. I get permission. I'm like, any way I can get up there? Can I get on that balcony? Or on the ship, I'm always up on the bridge and saying, can I just climb up there again? I promise. You know, I'll sign whatever waiver. But having that kind of overview perspective can be really engaging. And then
It works really well, especially if you're a small boat. Can't do it on a big ship. It's equipment, but on a small boat, if you put your boat
flying kite, it's really. I need to work on my kite flying skills. The drones, the quadcopters, there's several different the different types. I have access to them and access to the people that know how to use them for some of the science that we're doing. We've got a robotics lab, so we have grad students that are using the quadcopters on some of their coastal processes work to record changes. So it's easier for me to grab one of those, since they're really good pilots, and have them capture it. I have not gone through the training myself. I'm afraid I'm going to break it. But so I'm still kind of climbing up on the highest places I can and going from there. But again, they're another technology that's getting easier and easier to use. More folks are coming out with them. GoPro actually came out with their own, which looked really promising, called Karma. They had some really good marketing footage, and I got all excited. And then it came out, and they ended up recalling all of them because of issues. Apparently, they were just, the battery was dying, and they were literally falling out of the sky. So if you're investing in that kind of equipment, be sure to do your research. Don't let all the marketing kind of sway you. DJI Phantom is one of the companies that's been around for a long while. It's really been proven. A lot of scientists are using the DJI Phantom quadcopters in their work, and they're very a solid product. There's also some other things to consider with those. In the US, there's some FAA rules about where you can use them, so they don't obviously interfere with commercial aircraft. Our national parks do not allow them because someone out west, I think, at one of our beautiful hot springs, they crashed their drone into that. Now it's in that very fragile habitat. There's, of course, no way to get it out. So we've had some bad apples that have kind of ruined it for everybody. But they there are some pretty tough restrictions in some places, and I'm guessing it's the same over here.
Just quick look on Amazon, and there's some like quadcopters that are quite inexpensive, as much as €20. So what?
So when you're looking to get good quality footage, you want to make sure, like I mentioned, the DJI quadcopter. Some of them have built-in cameras that have really good stabilization. You want to read the reviews, because what happens is when the quadcopter goes up, it has four rotors that are moving, and it provides some shake. And the better companies and the more expensive ones have found out ways to deal with that shake. Because when you see the footage from the less expensive ones, photographers call it jello, because it literally looks like, you know, gelatin, how it kind of gets shaky and wobbly. The footage will look like that instead of getting that nice smooth shot. So there are different stabilizers you can get. They're called gimbals that ensure that your camera stays nice and steady. And then some of them, like the DJI, have versions that already have a really nice camera built in, and it's built in to stabilize correctly to get the good footage. So reviews are huge there. And there's several magazines and sites where you can get professional reviews. I usually don't go by Amazon reviews, because people tend to be a little snarky on there, or they might have one little issue and give it a one star because it's something that's really not a huge deal. So look for the more professional sites and people that are using it in their everyday work. And like I said, a lot of scientists are using them now. So we actually have a lot of back and forth between like our robotics lab and our communications to what's working for them, what footage they're getting, and how we can use that. So some of these you might already have in your institution. Someone might already be using it, where you can be like, hey, you know, you're getting great footage, and I know you don't have time to do anything with it. How can I help? And I've gotten some great, fantastic footage like that, where they've gotten all this stuff, they've just dumped it on a drive, and they're working on their research and pulling the data from it, but they've got no use for the clips, and it's just sitting there on a hard drive. So they'll let me come in with an external drive for an afternoon and go through and pull some footage, and then I can use it in a lot of different ways. So reduce, reuse, recycle whenever you can. And the last one, real time, following along. I talked about Facebook Live. Anytime that something really interesting is going on and you can bring the people right into that moment, that can be a lot of fun for folks too. They're scrolling through their Facebook feed and they see that University of Delaware is live now pulling up a trawl, and they can kind of experience that for a minute or two. Folks get a big kick out of that. And then again, it's archived there, so if they want to share it with other people, they can come in and take a look too. So that kind of immediacy can be a fun thing to use. First, I'm going to talk about some still images and just kind of basics of photography and thinking a little bit differently about things. We all know sunny days are absolutely beautiful and the best for capturing nice images. So when you've got the beautiful sunny day, try to think a little differently about capturing that sunset or the sunrise, how you can use other things in your frame of image, like water, to give a sense of place. If you took a picture of the sunset with the big sky and you've got the pretty clouds, it's great. But if you shift it just a little bit and you're kind of collecting that sky in the water, it gives it a little different feel. You get the serenity of how quiet it is. If you were just looking at the sun in the sky, you wouldn't get that feeling of the fact that there's no wind. The water's like glass. So a lot of times when I'm taking a picture, I won't just snap a picture. I'll take a look through the viewfinder. I'll kind of shift around, see if it looks any different. Kind of look up, look down, sometimes get low, and just see how that perspective changes the image. And sometimes you can be quite surprised. Sometimes when you're taking a sunset, the best picture is behind you, because the light, the warm light is absolutely so beautiful from that sun. It's glowing, everything behind you is glowing, but you don't know unless you turn around. So always kind of get yourself out of the viewfinder and kind of really look around you and see what's there. That's an example of, again, there was a beautiful sunset and I was on the beach and I turned around and there was that beautiful warm light just totally making the dunes glow. If I looked the other direction, there was a big ball of orange above some trees. It was pretty, but this ended up being a much more interesting shot, and then I could use it to talk about dune fences and coastal processes and how they help collect sand to build up the dunes. Sometimes it's better to wait after that beautiful sunset. I think basically the 10 to 15 minutes after the sunset can be some of the most beautiful times of the day. I was out at the beach, we were covering a program. The sunset, the sky was gorgeous. And again, I was just kind of spinning around and a kid was still using its his dip net in the water and was able to get the water coming off the dip net, the silhouette of the child. I didn't have to worry about getting the photo release because you cannot recognize the child. But this was 10 minutes after the sunset and it kind of told the story of what we were doing there much better than a traditional sunset image would have. And they say never shoot into the sun, but sometimes I find shooting into the sun, rules are made to be broken, especially in photography. Sometimes you can get some interesting images by just breaking that rule. If you're in the woods or someplace where you've got a filter to that sunlight, if you face that sun, you get that beautiful backlighting and you get kind of that glow around subjects. So don't think, okay, the sun's behind me, I have to put my back to it and take a picture here. Again, look at how the environment's affecting the light and how it can help make an image stronger. A lot of people do not like rainy and cloudy days, but sometimes you get some of the most beautiful images on that. In the Atlantic, we get some of the colors of the Atlantic much better on a foggy, misty day. It's not your traditional beach pick, but you can see why people call the Atlantic green because of all that's in there and the colors that you get. This was a picture that was actually taken on a quite beautiful sunny day. I was out supposedly taking pictures of bald eagles, and we had a cold front come through, and this was actually 3 o'clock in the afternoon, right in the middle of the day, where cold air came in. And totally, the water was so warm, the cold front came through, all of a sudden everything changed. The mist started rising and I had a whole different image for the day. So being aware of weather and weather changes can be really important, especially if you're out for the full day. It's another reason why to have your phone on you. You can constantly check the weather and see what's happening with it. But sometimes things like that can totally surprise you and give you a whole different feel for an image. Again, fog, mist, it's some of my favorite conditions to photograph in. It gives you much more kind of some mystery, sense of place. You want to know what's down that cloudy trail because it kind of gives you that fairy tale aspect. A lot of critters come out in the rain that you might not normally see. Birds can be more active. They got the worms coming out. We're out with a bunch of kids doing a nature program, and our eastern box turtles love the rain because the worms are coming out, and that's when their sources of protein, and you can get some wildlife that you usually don't get on a beautiful day. And storms can also be great. You've got a lot of movement, you've got a lot of moody light with the big clouds coming through, you've got the big waves. So if you've got the right protection for your equipment, don't go out with expensive equipment and just blast into a storm. But if you've got a good plastic cover, I've got a basic one. This one I always carry with me. Again, it's just a couple bucks. It's called a rain sleeve. It fits right over my lens. I can tighten it around, I can get my hand in there, I can take pictures, my camera stays dry. So I even use it on a boat if I know it's gonna be splashing. I'm just having something really simple like this to help protect you on a rainy day. Can be quite a useful tool. For coastal processes, I'm out in storms a lot. So it's one of those, always be prepared. If you are out on the water a lot, getting the view from a kayak can be a great thing, or a stand-up paddleboard if you've got the balance. Just giving that different perspective from actually being right on the water. Another great advantage of that is a lot of wildlife that are usually very wary of people walking through an area are much more welcoming to folks that are floating through. Especially a lot of the wading birds. We've got a big pelican. I'm still on the Boulder's beach. A big pelican colony nearby, and they really don't mind us floating up quietly in a kayak. We can get much closer. This is still taken with a zoom lens. You don't want to encroach in on the wildlife. But you can get shots like that out on a kayak, on a boat, that you wouldn't be able to from land. This is another example of a shot from a kayak. Does anyone know Misty of Chincoteague and Chincoteague Pony Penning from the U.S.? It's a story that a lot of kids read while growing up. They have a wild pony roundup once a year on this little Virginia island, and they actually swim the ponies across this little channel, and they auction off a lot of the young stock to keep the population down. And it's a fundraiser for the firefighters. But they always round them up, and they wait for a slack tide to make sure it's safe for them to swim across. And they keep them in the marsh nearby that's away from the public view. But if you jump in a little boat or a kayak, you can get right up close to a scene like this and get a different perspective. Almost all the other pictures you'll see from this event are them kind of going through the streets or swimming in the canal, but seeing them rest beforehand just gives you kind of a different view that most folks wouldn't see. And also wildlife getting the natural feeding activity of what they do. You can get much closer if you kind of get out there on the water. And also traveling, you can get a different perspective and a sense of place. I was in Venice 2 years ago and wanted to get up close and personal with the architecture, but I don't want someone else paddling me. I want to be paddling myself. Got that independent streak. So I looked around, and sure enough, I could rent a kayak. And my husband and I went, and we explored the city by kayak, and we got some really nice pictures and videos from that perspective, just because it's a water city, and I was able to see it in a way that you usually don't see unless you're in a gondola with someone singing to you, which just makes me uncomfortable. But so considering those options. And also when it comes to nature, just thinking about how to capture kind of wildlife phenomena, big flocks of geese that are migrating through, the changing color of leaves, kind of looking up, looking down, looking around, trying to figure out those different perspectives that really show what you're talking about. I find particularly on the beach, when we're talking about coastal erosion and storms, getting down really low and getting kind of right on that beach level gives you a different view, and you can see everything that was washed up and all the shells that are deposited. Getting really close to things like flowers and berries and kind of showing the color and the shape just gives you that different perspective. Same with insects and lichen and all the beautiful things that are out there. In wildlife, showing some of the interactions between critters, kind of really getting close and showing. Everybody knows that's a zebra just because from life experience, you know, if it's got black and white stripes and it's got fur, odds are it's a zebra. So kind of getting really close on that interaction of that little, I think they're called oxpeckers, to show that relationship. And also showing relationship between wildlife and humans and our effects on the environment. We've got a lot of wading birds that use things in our marine operations area that we've put there, and they're opportunistic and use it for feeding, and showing that kind of nature and man relationship. And getting into the water and showing our relationship with water too. This is a still GoPro shot that my husband was out surfing, and I just had him bring up his hand and take a couple quick pictures of kind of in the water and putting you in that environment. And interactions again between wildlife and also kind of once again our impacts on them. They're now nesting. These bald eagles are actually nesting on lights on a little league, a little baseball field for kids nearby. And we do some studies with some of the larger marine birds and can kind of show how they've adapted to kind of fit in of how we're impacting the environment that they live in. So when you're thinking about getting these different angles and perspectives, particularly if you're covering a specific story, you want to think about how you can put these images together to kind of tell a story on their own. Particularly if you're using social media and sharing throughout the day. Again, I'm big on multitasking. When I'm thinking about covering something, I want to be able to use what I get in several different ways. So this is an example of, we had a riptide expert, rip current expert come in from Australia and spend a day with our coastal processes specialist. And he was teaching some of our local lifeguards about the latest research and findings on rip currents and riptides and how to help people that get caught in them or how to anticipate their impacts and keep the beach safer. So I knew I was going to be out with them all day and collecting images throughout the day. I also knew the images were going to be used later in the article for our university magazine and online paper. So I wanted to get images that I could use on social media and kind of share throughout the day, but then also still be usable as an online photo album or to accompany a story that was written afterwards. So these are the images I ended up taking. I got started off with how many of our researchers and scientists are in front of a PowerPoint screen talking about their area of research. So got the typical workshop photo, made sure that his area of research was being shown on the screen. Even when you're taking these pictures, try to think about what exactly is on the screen and if it helps strengthen what you're talking about. And also, try to get a slightly different angle. We all have the kind of the straight on angle of the person talking with the screen next to them. So if you can get a little lower, a photo that shows a little more action, that always helps make it just a little bit more interesting. And then I've got all the characters that are involved in this story in their natural habitat. They're out on the beach. The riptide expert is talking to the leader of the beach patrol, who's also talking to our coastal processes specialist. So I have all of them interacting. It helps introduce the characters that we're going to see throughout the day. Show action whenever possible. So they were running drills. So always helps when you've got a nice beach scene and people in bathing suits, but you've got the action. It shows what these lifeguards do. They run out there, they help people, they've got their equipment, they're at the ocean. And whenever you can, give a sense of place. So this was happening on a local beach called Dewey Beach in Delaware. Anyone that's in the region knows Dewey Beach. It has quite a reputation. It's where all the college kids go in the summertime to work and live and hang out, and it's kind of a party place, so it's known. And Dagsworthy Street is one of the most well-known streets. So what I was able to do here is I was able to get the lifeguard stand in the picture, because we're talking to the lifeguards. We've got the Dagsworthy, which is a known street. The sign says, "Welcome to Dewey Beach," and there's also Rip Current sign right there, too. So this kind of sets the whole stage for the story. We know where we are, what we're talking about. You can see some of the characters on the side that we just met. So just kind of, in one image, we've got a whole sense of what's happening. We've got the lifeguards, we've got the signs of the rescue, we know where we are. It always helps to use some wide angles to give a sense of space, especially when you're in wide open place like the beach, just to give a sense of scale, to show that the ocean is a big place. And if you go out there, you might get into trouble, but the lifeguards are right there ready to help you. And whenever you can, use show some of the tools of the trade, some of the equipment that's being used. Try different angles to, here I just got down a little bit lower, right in front of it, to kind of really have those in focus as in the forefront, as this is what we're looking at, but we're still have the wider beach scene and sense of place there too. If you're covering something like a workshop or event where you don't have all this going on, sometimes it's fun just collecting expressions, showcasing personalities. This gentleman was quite the storyteller on one of the panels we had at NMEA. And so when I'm sharing, I wasn't able to do a live feed of this, but by sharing this series of pictures on social media, you kind of get the sense of he's quite the character telling the story, and you want to learn more about what he was talking about. So in this, I was just sitting there with my mobile phone, took like 6 or 7 pictures as he was really gesticulating wildly, and then I just knitted them together in another quick free app. This one I think was Diptych. I've got a couple links in the resources page. But again, it's a way, instead of just showing one picture, pulling those 4 pictures together and just giving a sense of one of the characters on social media kind of gives you a little more of a feeling of the event rather than just having one static picture. Stills, if you don't have access to a video or you don't feel comfortable editing video, you can still use still images effectively in a video. What I talked about yesterday was when I started with Delaware Sea Grant, we had all these great PSAs that were going out on the radio. PSAs are public service announcements. I'll try to avoid the alphabet soup as well. So these were recorded professionally, really good audio, really nice speaker because he's on the radio. And we already had these, so we're trying to figure out how else we could use them. And at the time, we had some great still images. So we just pulled together the still images with the gentleman doing the PSA. And then we were able to have videos that we could put on YouTube with this information that also helped illustrate it.
This is Sea Talk, ocean news from the University of Delaware. Seafood is a great low-calorie choice for a healthy diet. It's easier to digest than red meats and poultry, and it's full of proteins and vitamins. Follow these shopping tips to help keep this perishable menu item safe to eat. Whole fish should have bright, clear eyes that are often protruding, bright red or pink gills, firm yet elastic flesh, and shiny skin. Your purchase should feel cold, not cool, to the touch, and it shouldn't smell fishy. The odor should be like that of a fresh sea breeze. Make it one of your last purchases, and no matter what time of year it is, if your trip home is more than an hour, pack the seafood on ice. This is Sea Talk, a public service announcement from the University of Delaware, the Delaware Sea Grant College Program, and this station.
So it's just a quick example of we had this PSA on the radio that had really good information, but it talked about a lot of things that you're supposed to be looking for that are hard to try to imagine if you're not used to looking for these things if you're shopping for seafood. So by just putting them with some still images, you can just move kind of from one part of the image to another to have that sense of movement. It's called the Ken Burns effect. Any of the real basic editors, it's really easy to put that in. You just pick the starting point and the end point, and it automatically moves from one to the other for you. So it gives you kind of the video feel without having to use actual video clips. So that's always an option as well to help show something if you've got a nice little audio clip that you want to illustrate with images as well. We're talking about video. Again, using variety and embracing your limitations can be a good thing. Never feel overwhelmed, just figure out how to make it work. If you have a very long or busy event, you can do a time lapse. Anymore, most of the smartphones actually have a time lapse feature built in. So you can put your phone up, set it on time lapse, walk away for a couple minutes, come back, stop it, and it'll automatically speed up that footage for you. In this case, it was a sunrise. There's also an app that's linked with Instagram called Hyperlapse that will do it for you very smoothly. They make it very, very simple. It used to be you had to set up a camera, take a picture every couple seconds, and then you had to put all those pictures together and speed it up. And that process takes a lot longer, but now you can do it right off of your phone very easily. This is an example I talked about using the GorillaPod to put the GoPro up. This was before my phone had time-lapse feature. So I put the GoPro up in the corner of this tent. You can see kind of the structure of it. I was able to hang off of there. This was a big seafood tasting event in Washington, D.C. that I went with our seafood specialist, and we were making chowder samples for everybody. So I knew I was going to be busy throughout the event helping her get the chowder out and taking some pictures here and there. So I set the GoPro up, set it up to take a picture, I think like every 5 seconds, and just let it run for the 2 hours of the event. As soon as the event was over and we got cleaned up, I pulled it down, pulled the card out, popped it into my laptop, and then I could just use iMovie to condense all those images down into this time lapse. And then we were able to share it out right there and say, hey, if you missed this event, here's an idea of how busy it was. Great to see everybody. And we had several partners like NOAA, another Sea Grant program from up north, that were also able to share it. And so we were able to kind of share it with our community partners too. But it just gives you a sense of how busy it was. So if you know you're going to have something that's going to keep you running around, but it might be a cool way to capture kind of the feel of the event, a time lapse is a great way to go. Also, if you have something that's happening quite slowly over time, if you're doing an example of Some folks do examples of sea level rise using ice in warm water versus ice in cold water. And you know it's going to take a while to see that difference. You can set up the camera with a demonstration like that and do a time lapse and then share it very quickly afterwards so folks don't have to sit there and watch it for 2 hours. You can say, this is what we did, and here it is condensed down into a minute. And they can see it happen very quickly and easily. You can also slow things down. This is my boy Boomer. There's also a slow-mo feature on phones now where you can capture things in slow motion and really slow something down. So if you have something that's happening really quickly, like a balloon popping or something that sparks, you can use that slow-mo feature to capture that and really slow it down so people can see exactly what's happening. For this demo, we just stuck peanut butter on Boomer's nose. So he was my demo dog, but you can see I had no idea how long this dog's tongue was until I did this. But you can see how effective it is in slowing something way down. Again, this is just handheld phone. So peanut butter is given to the subject, and we go slow-mo. He really likes peanut butter. I think right here is when I got really surprised. Yeah, right there. But in science, a lot of things happen really quickly, and like that. And you can get great footage right from your phone and really slow that down and let people help people understand what might happen in the blink of an eye and capture that. And those are some of the things that really have that wow factor and are really shareable and kind of bring the science back to an understandable level for folks. Was there a question? Yeah. It's not going to work because of frame rate. So what happens in a traditional video, it captures so many frames per second. So if you slow down those frames per second, they're not going to catch every step. So in the slow motion, it captures a much higher frame rate, so many more frames per second. So you can really draw that out and see. So if you already have footage, unless it was taken at a really high frame rate, which more advanced cameras do, you probably won't be able to slow it down much. You can slow it down a little. In iMovie, Movie Maker, there's when I'm in there later demonstrating, I can show you where that setting is. They simplify things as well. They've got turtle speed to rabbit speed. So you can slow it down a little bit to the turtle, or you can really speed it up to rabbit. But it's much easier to speed things up than it is to slow it down because of how it captures those frames. This is just another example of just using a slightly different angle to capture things. This was just GoPro on the stick where I held it just right down next to the water's edge to get a slightly different view of the sunset on the water. I do this sometimes with some B-roll and just kind of panning up. If it's a really beautiful day and I've got some extra time, I'll go out and capture some of these clips just to have in the library. They work really well for kind of like opening sequences or credit sequences, just to have on hand to have a little kind of visual eye candy to use in different places. This was a shark tagging trip we were on, where again, this was just the GoPro. Had my hand over the side to show the process. I should have been a little steadier. We were capturing pretty big sand tiger sharks. So I had my hand in the water for that. And when I saw it come up, you saw the camera go whoop, because I wasn't sure how big it was until I got it up. Once I saw it was a dogfish, I put it back down. But this is the type of thing we can show how they're captured. It goes all the way through to them unhooking it, and you get it back down in the water to show it to swimming away. But we can show those processes, especially when it comes to when we actually tag them. So here you can kind of see it swimming away. So just a quick little clip I was able to get with the GoPro that we can then use for some of the different research stories. And then this is an example of working with what you have to kind of bring small things to life for folks. A lot of the science that we do is under the microscope, and a lot of people don't get to look into the microscope and see the things, but actually you can capture quite a good imagery with your smartphone again, just being really careful and getting into the eyepiece and capturing some of these things. This was a 15-second science we did on litter. We did a series on kind of marine debris and ways that people can make changes in their everyday lives to help prevent it. So this was on cigarette butts, which a lot of people don't realize that the filters on cigarettes are not biodegradable. They think they're made of cotton or some sort of fabric, when they're actually made of plastics, they don't biodegrade. So we wanted to kind of show that for folks. The only problem was we had this great idea. This is about planning, the planning process. We're like, we're going to do this about cigarette butts. They're plastic. They don't biodegrade. So came up with a script, and we shot it, and then we couldn't find a cigarette butt because our campus went smoke-free. So I literally ran down the street because I know that at stop signs, people tend to flick their cigarettes out. I'm like, I know if I go down to the corner, I'll be able to find one. So I literally run down to the corner, and I'm looking through the grass. I find one, pick it up, go running back, and not being a smoker, I didn't realize it was still smoldering. Got back to the lab, and I'm like, whew, it really smells like cigarettes in here. Well, that's because someone must have flicked it out like seconds before I went down there, and it was still burning. So we took it, we dissected it, we put it under the scope. I just stuck my phone in there to get this little shot of the plastic fibers, and then we had our episode. So I'll show you that.
Did you know that nearly all cigarette filters contain a form of plastic that is not biodegradable? And cigarette butts are consistently the number one item found in coastal cleanups worldwide. Please dispose of your cigarette butts responsibly.
So again, just giving them a little peek in that microscopic view is really simple. These lenses are tiny. They fit right over an eyepiece. And you can get, I've gotten everything from little skeleton shrimp to all sorts of critters that we've kind of captured there and gotten it on video just fine, just using my phone. They also make more sophisticated adapters that actually click right onto microscopes, and you can get better footage, but it is possible just using it by hand. And then this is just an example of taking advantage of the moment and what's happening and what might be unexpected around you. This is, again, Chris, who I work very closely with. This was an unexpected video that we made really quickly and put on social media, again, just using the phone. We were stuck in the meeting all day. We were in this whole exact same situation, and we had the polar vortex coming through. So it was super cold, much colder than any of us were used to. We were all miserable, and everyone was complaining on social media about how cold it is. So at the end of the meeting, we're trying to get rid of all the catering stuff, put everything away, and we had our hot water for tea, and we had our hot coffee, and Chris looks at me, and he's like, let's try to make snow. All right. So I grabbed my phone. We both run out without jackets, which was very silly, but we were so excited about this. And so this is just basically him taking the tea out and throwing it up in the air in this really cold temperature to see what would happen.
This way. All right, ready?
So that was just a really quick, unexpected, shareable moment I shared right out onto social media, but linked it to the polar vortex and what we're experiencing. Side note, we did try it with the coffee too. It does not work with coffee. So if you try this yourself, forget the coffee, just use the hot water. But sometimes those and just having the natural sound and having the one other person and I kind of laughing and, you know, again, we're science geeks, we're excited about this, but it got shared really widely from everything I put on Instagram and YouTube, and a bunch of our partners shared it out, and then our local weather station actually shared it out as an example of kind of the whole process at work and how to make your own snow. So just embrace those moments when they come up, and sometimes those can be the most fun, and always find a way to link it back to the work that you're doing. How are we doing on time? We've got just a couple more quick ones. Sometimes when you're out in an event, just getting a bunch of very fast clips throughout the day can kind of give a nice view of the whole event. This first one, I was basically chasing kids with a GoPro. So that was an example of an event. I was there throughout the day to take pictures for the university, take a lot of still pictures, but I had the GoPro kind of with me on the stick the whole time, and I just took 3 to 5 second clips throughout the day as we went from station to station. And a couple days later, I was able to take all those clips, stitch them together to kind of give a bigger picture of the whole day and the fun, and I was exhausted running after the children. But we were then able to use that in several different ways. It went along with the university story. It was a new wind program we were debuting for elementary school kids. But then they could also, Chris used it as a promotional video afterwards to send out to teachers and say, if you bring your children here for a wind program, this is all that they'll do throughout the day, to give them a taste of that. So again, it was able to be used in many different ways. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yep. And actually, I shared a couple of the short clips before I put the bigger one together. Yeah.
Is that your source of your best source for uncopyrighted
music? I have a list of resources. Okay. I have several go-tos. He's one of my favorite, just because this in ComTech, he produces music for people to use, free of use. So you don't have to spend an arm and leg for different music. And he's got it set up so you can actually search by feel. So on that one, I searched for Bright and Bouncy, because the kids were bright and bouncy. And his site gave me some great tracks that went exactly to give that feeling. So the resource PDF that's online, it has a list of resources for royalty-free imagery, because you can't get pictures of everything yourself, especially when you're talking about planet Earth or deep ocean. There's great resources for getting those images. and video clips and visualizations. NASA has some really nice visualizations available for use, and then also music. Because in all this, you want to make sure that you are not using any copyrighted material. YouTube will be on you like that. And all of these resources also have exactly how, this is exactly how he asked to be credited in it. And then I make sure that's always in the video, and I make sure it's with the description that I post as well, just to give him the credit, because really appreciate him doing that and like to share that. And then one more example from kind of the everyday, we've got our seafood specialist Doris, who does seafood technology, seafood safety. We started also doing, because she does a lot of contests and workshops, we started a In the Kitchen with Delaware Sea Grant series, showing her properly preparing some of the favorite dishes. So kind of giving that perspective. So this got us an audience of foodies that we might not otherwise get the attention of, because they have no idea that Delaware Sea Grant, Science Serving the Delaware Coast, deals in seafood preparation and cooking and recipes. We have a big crab cake cook-off each year. It's part of our annual open house. And the winning recipe each year, we get out, we get their name out, we put in a cookbook. So we also have cookbooks available. But so Niche, she just goes through the whole process, and you can just follow along, because a lot of people love crab cakes, but they don't know how to prepare them correctly. So it just goes through each step. I'll just kind of go, since we're tight on time. But then we're, this turned into her going on some local news segments to talk about her work. And then they linked back to our YouTube videos. If you're interested in the latest, you know, crab cake cook-off recipe, you can see how to make it here. So again, in thinking about what you're producing and how it can be used in different ways, a lot of times news organizations, particularly now, they're facing the huge budget cuts and they don't have the personnel. Anytime that you can put out a press release and say, we've got B-roll footage that goes with this, or we've got a great video that goes with this, it really helps your press release get more attention too. Particularly, I know with our local news on their websites, they're always, they don't have a photographer they can send out to everything, but if we can send something along with three great photographs and a link to a couple videos that actually show it, they love it, because they can run the story, they can do their own, you know, their journalist might add some extra questions and do an interview, but then we've already given them the multimedia content that they can use on their site. And that's kind of a bonus for them. I've got a couple more 15-second science examples in addition to yesterday. The first one is just talking, showing about getting creative, about showing some things that might be really complex. In this case, we're talking about twisting DNA. We weren't quite sure how to show that, so we ended up actually using a Sharpie and a rubber band and writing on the rubber band to show the twisting. And on the second one, again, when we're talking about the deep sea, I obviously can't run out and jump in the submersible and get footage of that. So sometimes we have to make really basic graphics to show what we're talking about. So these show each of those examples.
A basic principle of chemistry is that at high temperatures, molecules move faster. Microbes that live at high temperatures, like those that live inside hydrothermal vents, protect their DNA from heat by twisting it more using an enzyme called reverse gyrase.
So that's just I call it the MacGyver solution. Use what you have on hand to demonstrate something very quickly. Whoops.
A basic principle of chemistry is that at high temperatures, molecules move faster.
There we go.
The Did you know that more people have been to the moon than to the Halo Zone? The Halo Zone exists in ocean trenches deeper than 6,000 meters. Very little life can be found that deep to the high pressure, which can be equal to the weight of 50 jumbo jets.
So Rosa's one of the people that we use that does both Spanish and English, but we're trying to figure out how to get across that sense of that immense weight. So in figuring out, we're like, okay, 50 giant planes, the easiest way to show that is have a simple graphic and put it up there, the 50 planes, because that's a concept that's really hard to imagine. So in thinking about your visualizations for some of the more complex things, breaking it down to something that people know in their everyday lives, like a giant plane or an elephant or the length of a school bus or the height of the Statue of Liberty, using those kind of indicators and making very simple graphics can really help get that across when you're not able to actually show it. And I'll actually stop here and do the rest of this, kind of goes with the afternoon, because I think we're supposed to stop at 12:30 and I'm a little over.